So I wanted to just go over some of the highlights of this paper on tiny data. This has been a very influential paper, although it dates back to just 2014. You continue to see references to it in current packages and documentation and papers. It's called Tidy Data by a guy called Hedley Wickham, who's one of the leading people behind the R Studio project. And what he's really after here is to convey ways that we can clean up data in such a way that it's simpler to use for data analytics and data visualization. He points out that there's a huge amount of effort that's been spent trying to clean up data. So you get data from the wild and then have to spend a bunch of time processing it into a form that makes it straightforward to use in an actual visualization or for analysis. And what he's proposing here is some standard ways of formulating data so that it's easy to kind of put into the analytical and visualization pipeline. And what he's calling that new format is called tidy data as opposed to messy data or untidy data. He points out here it said that 80% of data analysis is spent on the process of cleaning and preparing the data. So you'd like to think that you're going to actually be able to do something useful with the data, but you spend a bunch of time up front monkeying with it to get it into a format where you can actually do something with it. And that's definitely been true in my experience as well. So one of the interesting things, if you have a connection back to the database world, one of the interesting aspects of this is that the principles here are tied to those of relational databases. So the notion of relational integrity, the relational algebra, how we represent things that can be easily codified into a relational model, are also relevant to the use of the data in this context as well. Okay, so what does Wickham mean when he's talking about tiny data? He makes an interesting quote here: "Happy families are all alike. Every unhappy family is unhappy in its own way." And then he makes the same statement about data. He says, "Tidy data sets are all alike, but every messy data set is messy in its own way." That's really true, right? What we're trying to do is get back to the tidy case where they're all the same and we can treat them the same and use the same tools on them. He gives a simple example here of, well, this turns out to be what he'll call messy data, but this little table that gives information about treatments that are given to different patients, apparently. What he's trying to show here is that there's not really any rhyme or reason to just talking about these things as rows and columns, that we need something that's more specific than that. And he illustrates that by showing table 2 here, which is basically just taking table 1 and transposing it along the diagonal. And it's exactly the same data, same values inside, but now rows are columns and columns are rows. So obviously there's nothing particularly useful about those distinctions. So his first job here in the paper is to try to give some definitions, some new semantics to how we talk about data. So the first idea he highlights here is this notion of the data set is a collection of values. So basically the content of a table that we were seeing up here above, right? These different treatment outcomes or whatever this data are attempting to show are the values that are being shown. So the values are there or equivalently up here in that original table. And those are usually going to be numbers if it's quantitative data, right? So this case, or just string values if it's qualitative data. So, you know, good, bad, indifferent versus 5, 10, 15, 20. And the values are organized in two ways, in particular. And so this is kind of his replacement for the very generic words, rows and columns. So a value belongs to a variable, first of all, which is really going to end up being the columns in the tidy data, and an observation, which are going to end up being the rows in the tidy data. So a variable, again, a column, contains all values that measure the same underlying attribute, right? So in the previous examples, if we're looking at this version of the data, treatment A and treatment B would be the values. And all of the values in that column are measurements for treatment A. All the values in the second column are values for treatment B. So that's what he means when he says that the variable contains all the values for the same underlying attribute. So height, temperature, duration, and so forth across the different observations that you're making. And then secondly, a variable is also part of an observation. So an observation is all the values measured on the same unit, right? So the same person, the same day, the same race, or whatever, across all the attributes. So the variables, again, correspond to the columns. And the observations correspond to the rows in the tidy data. Okay, so here's a different version of that same data set where we've now tidied the values. We've got a particular treatment is one of the variables, and then the result of that treatment. So in the previous example, we're kind of crossing the streams here, right? Here's one type of treatment, here's another type of treatment. Instead of having those different variables for the same observation for John Smith or Jane Doe, we're going to split those out into a format where we just talk about the treatment. So the treatment can either be treatment A or treatment B for each of these observations, right? So John Smith, his result for treatment A, John Smith, his result for treatment B. Similarly, Jane Doe's treatment A, Jane Doe's treatment B, right? So we're giving specific information about the observations for each of the possible values of that treatment variable. And then the result of that, the values themselves for John Smith's treatment A result is indeterminate, apparently. Jane Doe's treatment A is given a value of 16, whatever the units are for that. Again, the terminology for the tidy data is that the variables are the columns and the observations are the rows. And then the values are make up the body of the table. And each of these values, like this value here that I've called out here, says, well, this value belongs to both a single observation, Mary Johnson, and a single variable, the treatment that's been applied to Mary. So this now satisfies the same values as in that first example table up above, but we've now got the variables in the columns and the observations in the rows. Okay, so here's kind of the three criteria that he defines to make tidy data. So first of all, each variable forms a column. We've seen that already. Each observation forms a row. And then each type of observational unit forms a table. And this third criteria kind of has more to do with normalizing the data in a database sense. So he points out here that this is COD's third normal form, basically. And we'll come back to this third one in a little bit later in the discussion. But he concludes then here that table three, the table that we were looking up here, is the tidy version of what was originally proposed in table one, right? So this is messy data, this is now tidy data, and that's what we're trying to get to. Okay, now what he's after here is giving us some best practices that allow us to take kind of an arbitrary data set that's messy and turn it into a tidy data set. And what he's basically doing is collecting together from his experience in creating tidy data sets, the kinds of operations that need to be done on a typical data set in order to make it tidy. So we're not going to talk about all these in as much detail as he does. You can read more about them. But there's five different techniques he's got in view here in sections 3.1 through 5. So let's start with the first here, where column headers are values and not variable names. Remember that in the tidy data set, the columns should correspond to these variables. What treatment did you apply? What was the temperature that you measured? What was the time for the race? Those sorts of things. That's the tidy case. In the messy case, the headers can actually be values and not just the variables that say that this column has values in it, which makes for a not tidy data set. So here's an example from a Pew survey that talks about the average income. So the income here is in these columns, average income for different religious groups in the U.S., I think. So this is just the first 10 rows of this data set. So you can see that there's different religions, and then there's different income levels, less than 10,000, 10,000 to 20,000, and so forth. And he's actually removed some of the columns to get them to fit onto the page. But you can see that the columns here, the less than 10,000, 10 to 20,000, 20 to 30,000, those are actually values, right? This isn't a variable like income. This is actually a value. So this is therefore not considered to be tidy data. Now, he does point out that this turns out to be a particularly useful way to do data entry, for example, if we're trying to put in information that says, well, a Catholic that is, a person that's a Catholic will make between 40 and 50K and 638 of the cases surveyed. So it's super helpful in terms of just tabulating the data, doing the data entry, maybe even actually being able to start doing some analytics on it if you want to treat this as a whole matrix. But it isn't tidy data in the sense that it's going to be useful or easy to use it with various data analytical tools. What he's going to do with this then, to show a simpler example here, table 5, here's the raw data that's coming in. And it's got the same format as what we saw up here with the income data. So we've got a particular observation, so case A, case B, case C, and then for these different values, A, B, and C, of each of these cases, we see the particular values associated with them. So this is the raw case, and in the table up above, these are the different income levels, and these are the actual counts of the number of people at that income for each of these religious groups. The operation he's performing on this he refers to as melting, and you'll see that there's actually a melt operation in pandas, for example. You're taking and you're converting this information in a way that allows you to come up with just the particular column and value for each of these combinations of values in the original table, but by breaking them out specifically as variables instead of values as the column headers. So for category A, we see here's the AA data, the AB data, the AC data, right? So, and that's 1 corresponding to this 1, 4 corresponding to this 4, 7 corresponding to this 7, and so forth for both B and C. So we've now created a tidy version of this original table. So the data, as he points out here in the caption, the information in the table is exactly the same, it's just stored in a different way. And it turns out that this is a way that makes it more useful to do analytics on that resulting data set. Again, some additional terminology. So the data set, going back to the original Pew data set here, the data set really has 3 variables, right? And we mean variables in the sense of tidy data, what we want to have show up as 3 different columns. The variables are the person's religion, their income, and then the number of times that particular income is reported for that particular religion, and he's calling that the frequency. So in order to tidy up the original Pew data, we need to do this same melt operation that we've been discussing. So it's called melt, or other people refer to it as stacking the data, and you can kind of see how we're taking this shape of data and sort of melting it down into multiple rows in this second form. When we're thinking about how do we do that melting operation, the first thing we want to look for is that is columns that are already variables. So in the case of the Pew data, well, the variables that we have are, again, religion, income, and frequency. So in the original data, we've already got a column that is one of those variables, right? So the religion column is already a variable in the tiny data sense. And he introduces some terminology here. He calls this a column variable or a call var. It's a column that's already a variable. So this is already the format that it should be in. But these other columns in the rest of the table are not already variables. So these are the ones that are going to be subject to melting. And the religion column is going to remain the same because it's already a variable. So when he says melting is parameterized by a list of columns that are already variables or call vars, and by parameterized he means that that's sort of the values that we're going to have remain fixed in each of the instances of the non-call vars that we're going to melt down into a tidy form. The other columns, so the remaining columns in this case, are going to be converted into 2 variables. And again, because each variable represents a column in the data, that means that those things are going to turn into 2 columns. And he calls these super generically. The new variable is going to be called just column, which is sort of confusing. And the other is going to be called the value. that's going to have the particular values for that column. Here's an example of, and well, using that terminology, we're going to go from this initial data here, the messy data. We're going to maintain this call var because it's already a variable, and we're going to convert all the rest of the data into two new columns that capture the income and the frequency of that income for that particular religion. And that's the beginning of that table is what's shown here. So we're keeping this call var, the thing that's already a variable, the religion call var, and we're creating two new columns, which in the generic terminology he's used up above, he refers to as column and value. But we know that these, for this particular data set, correspond to the income of a person with this religious conviction, and then the number of people that fall into that income level with this religious conviction. That's the frequency. Again, the Pew data set has one call var, religion, and the melting yields table 6, right? That was what we were just looking at. And he makes some further comments about that. He says that the variable column has been renamed to income, which we just saw, and the value column to frequency. So as I'm showing you, here's his generic terminology, column and value. And for this particular data set, after we do the melting, we get different incomes and different frequencies. He concludes here finally that this is tidy because each column represents a variable and each row represents an observation, which are the two of the criteria for tidiness. There's the third one we're not really addressing yet. If we go back up here to the definitions of tidy data, we've satisfied the first criterion. We've got variables as columns and observations as rows. And it turns out that this already satisfies this constraint of being an observational unit. So basically the income for a particular religious group corresponds to a coherent, consistent observational unit. He shows an additional example here of billboard chart rankings. So here's the original data. The original data is here. So we've got the year, the artist, the track, the time, the date entered. All of these things are specifying a particular tune, and then the rest of the columns here are the rankings in the billboard charts for the first week, the second week, the third week, and so forth. Turns out that these things are call vars, right? Because they're individual values that correspond they're individual variables that correspond to specific values in the data set. Whereas these guys are not call vars because they are labeled not as variables, but as values, right? Which week, not the particular ranking with the week broken out into a separate column. So when he melts that, the call vars are going to remain the same, and we can see the final version down here. So the call vars remain fixed, and you can see now we have multiple entries for this particular song, right? For each of the weeks that song was on the chart. So here's week 1, 2, 3, and so forth, and here was its rank in that week. And then we got similar data for the next song, the week and the ranking. So we've taken that original data that's not in a call var format. These aren't variables, they're actually column headers that are values, and we've turned them into actual values, right? So the week number and the corresponding rank, that's what he referred to earlier as the column and the value, right? So the column in this melt turned into the week, and the value turned into the rank within that week. A second problem that's covered in this paper is having multiple variables in the same column. This is, if you're a database person, this is the equivalent of having multiple values stored in the same cell of a database table, which we know is a bad thing. So the example data that is used here is this information about tuberculosis. What it's showing is the various countries and the year of the measurements, and then the columns actually not only have values instead of variables in the headers, but the columns themselves actually encode multiple pieces of information. So the first two columns, the country and the year, are actually call vars. So the first step in remedying this situation is to do a melt operation. And if we scroll down here, we can see that in this version of the data, we've now melted the columns down. So we have the column and the values, the information about this, the sex and age of victims, and the number of recorded cases in that year for that country. So although it has been melted, we've dealt with that first key problem, it's still not tidy data because we've got information encoded inside of the column here. What these are saying basically is, like for this example, we're saying males between the ages of 55 and 64. So we want to extract the information that's embedded inside of those things and turn it into individual variables. So that's what's shown here in the second part of this figure. Is the tidy version has new variables called sex and age, maybe better called age range, but you get the idea. So we've now made that explicit for each of the observations going down the rows. Okay, one of the other things that he points out here is that not only does this tidying up make it easier for us to do analysis, but it also makes it easy for us to add additional information to this table. So in its original form up here, if we wanted to add, for example, information about the population of a country or something like that, the population of the people that could potentially have gotten the disease or whatever, we have to make some modifications to that table in order to do that. Whereas in this case, we could add that population information very easily by just adding a new variable, a new column, and then associate that with all of the countries. That, of course, violates the collecting together tabular information in an appropriate way, but we'll come to that later. A third way that this is done is when we have not only variables that are being stored in columns, which is what we've been seeing so far, but we also might have a situation where we have variables that are being stored in rows. And the author calls this out as the most complicated form of messy data. What he's showing as an example here is the weather data that's shown here in Table 11. So there's a weather station identifier, the year and the month of the observation, and then the data for the day within that month, so day one, day two, day three, and so forth for each of the months, is recorded in additional columns here. So again, we have a value that's being used as a column, the day number, and furthermore, so we've got values that are showing up in columns, but we also have values that are showing up in rows. As you can see, for 2010 in January, we've got T-max and T-min. So this is kind of the moral equivalent of having values in columns, except now we've got them in rows. And we want to eliminate that. We've identified already the call vars, so ID, year, and month constitute the call vars that we want to use when we're going to melt this. But in this case, because we've also got values that are stored in rows, we're going to also use this element, or measure, maybe better be called measurement, this measurement element column as part of the melt. So in addition to the call vars, we're also going to melt using this. What that gives us then is the molten melted data, where we've now taken each of the individual measurements. So here's the same weather station for January of 2010, and we split this out for to give us the T max value and the T min value. So we've taken the rows that are kind of encoding that data and brought it down into this melted version. But now what we see here is that we've got an individual variable instead of having a different column for each of the original values, the day. We've actually folded the day value into the date column here. So we've not only melted along the year and the month up here, we've also converted that into a standardized date format so that it'll be easier to work with in the future. So we're not only doing the melt, but we're also cleaning up the data as we go. We still, though, have data that's being stored in rows, right? Although we have used the element column as if it was a call var, and then just melted the information in the rows to the right of that, we're still left with values in the rows. And so the solution to that is to just break these guys out as individual variables. So instead of having to look in multiple rows to get the information for a single observation, right? You could see these two values taken together as one observation, but they're split across multiple rows because we have this additional type of observation going on. In this version, now when we have, so this is actually what he calls officially tidy, we have a single observation that has the weather station, the date, including both the month and the date, the year and the month and the day, and then the two different temperature measurements have been broken out as separate variables. So that's now a tidy data set. And we can also, if we wanted to, for example, add, say, precipitation or other weather information to this table, it'd be simple to do that because it's already been tidied. We would add a new variable for precipitation, and for each of the observations for a particular station on a particular day, we'd have a nice convenient place to store that precipitation, and it maintains the tidiness of the data set. The operation that was happening here to convert from tmin and tmax in multiple rows into the tidy format, he refers to as either casting or unstacking. So we have melting and casting. I guess the analogy there has to do with casting something out of molten metal into something more solid. So it's sort of the opposite of melting. Maybe you would have called it freezing, but I'm from Minnesota. The other type of problem that the author addresses in this paper that I want to talk about is the notion of having multiple types of data in one table. And this is the illustration that he uses for this case has to do with the Billboard data for songs. So you notice that this is the tidied version of that song data, but you notice that we have rows that have considerable amount of redundant information where the same information is stored for the same song many, many times. And this is obviously a bad strategy in terms of making sure the data remain consistent and they can be updated easily and those sorts of things. So these are the same kinds of concerns that we encounter when we're talking about database normalization. We've got redundant data that we don't want to have multiple copies of, because as soon as you have redundancy, you have the potential for the data becoming out of date or out of sync with itself. The author shows a way to normalize this information. So here we've got two tables. It's not immediately clear that there's two things here, but they're split up right there. What he's done here is taken the data for the song and just reduced it to one instance of that information per song. So we have the artist, the track, and the duration, but we're only storing that in one row of this table. In order to be able to connect that information to other data, like the ranking of that song on particular weeks, he's introduced a new column called an ID column. This is, in this case, just a sequential list of integers that's associated with each song. And then in the second table over here, we've got that same ID, right? So ID1 refers to that same song on this table. We're now able to store the position on the charts for that particular song on specific dates and giving its rank. So now we've eliminated the redundancy in the data, which is always best. The challenge with that is that at the end of this section, he says, normalization is useful for tidying and eliminating inconsistencies. That's sort of what we've got so far. However, there's a caveat here. In the case of the visualization tools, it's going to be difficult for us to work with data that's in that kind of relational form. So the analytical tools usually allow us to denormalize the data, which is basically the 25-cent word for merging the data sets back into one table, one tidy table, so that we can make use of that single table to be able to do further processing on the data. And we'll see that the Pandas toolkit has things like join and merge that allow us to do those merges to take the normalized data and denormalize it in preparation for analysis and visualization. The remainder of this paper just looks at tools for tidying data. A lot of these, because the author, of course, is strongly connected to RStudio, are written about R. I'm going to give you a link with this video to a similar paper that talks about how to do these same things using the Python toolchain with pandas and NumPy and the other tools that we've already been talking about.